So we will now leave the subject of radiation mechanisms. Now, what is the takeaway from what we have discussed so far regarding pulsar radiation? As would have been obvious to you, that pulsar magnetosphere in the presence of very strong magnetic field, very high electric fields, fast rotation and so on, is an extremely complex environment. And although many attempts have been made over the years to understand emission processes, we are still very far away from capturing the full complexity of the magnetosphere in any of these attempts. And that includes the most recent attempts of modeling the magnetosphere and trying to understand radiation as a new point in a full ab initio nuclear numerical fashion. Because to address the problem of the scale that a neutron star really is still far beyond the ability of the current computational resources. So people try to do it in some scaled manner, and that will have its own limitations. However, I think at least in the context of incoherent emission mechanism and overall structure of the magnetosphere, there has been significant advances in the last few years, part of the last decade. Coherent emission, although many physical ideas exist, progress I would say is still very slow, and the full explanation of all the observed phenomenology pulsar radio emission is yet to be attempted in any of these models. And partly because capturing the full complexity for coherent emission in such a complex environment is even more difficult than trying to understand incoherent emission. So that's where we are. So for the able and the brave, there is a lot of ground still open to cover, and some people are trying to do it. If you guys want to do it, you're welcome. I know Minazur has been working on some aspects, but usually all these aspects that different people are working on, they need to be connected overall in some picture at some point. So that we are still at some distance from that. So with those remarks, I'll now move away from pulsar magnetosphere and emission mechanism and go to the interior. So this lecture, and if I don't finish this lecture, in the next lecture we'll deal with the interior. So I've titled this neutron stars and the equation of state, but equation of state is sort of an all-encompassing word about a lot of our physics that goes on inside the neutron star. Okay, so let's start at the beginning. We're going to talk about the structure of a neutron star. So in order to find the structure of a neutron star, you need to solve a hydrostatic equilibrium. So for hydrostatic equilibrium, you have to write the hydrostatic equilibrium solution. So what you have to start with is the local metric tensor. And the local metric tensor is not necessarily given to you ab initio. The metric tensor component need to be derived based on the specific situation. Then we define the stress energy tensor. Epsilon is the energy density, P is the pressure, C is 1. And this is the standard expression for EUA at the four velocities. And G is in the kick tensor. So this describes the matter distribution and its properties. And then, to close the system of equations, you need to have an equation of state, where you need to connect these two quantities, energy density and pressure, which appear in the stress energy tensor. That's what we call equation of state. And then, finally, you have Einstein's equation. RAB minus half GABR is 8 pi GC to the power of divided by 6 to the 4 times the stress energy tensor. So this is the equation you have to solve to get the values of GAB. Once you have got the values of GAB, then you can define the derivatives, the local covariant derivatives and contravariant derivatives. They involve the metric coefficients. Once you have the metric coefficient, then you can use this equation, the covariant derivative of TAB equal to 0. That gives you an equilibrium solution. So that's the equation of aristotelic equilibrium. But it's a given equilibrium solution. But hydrostatic equilibrium will come when we put the time derivative to 0. So, from equation of motion, you get hydrostatic equilibrium by putting time derivative to 0. So, this is basically the route which you have to follow to get the equilibrium structure. The details of the properties of matter is encoded in the equation of state. Now, the solution under different circumstances will give you different metric coefficients. For example, if there is rotation, you get some kind of metric coefficient. If there is magnetic field in general, then you might get deformation due to magnetic field. You get some metric coefficients and so on. So the most common approximation in which this equation is solved is zero rotation and spherical symmetry. So that gives you the TAB semicolon B equal to 0 and putting delta L T equal to 0. You get this in case of non-rotating spherically symmetric situation. So that gives you the dPdr, this is the pressure gradient, because it's spherically symmetric. The only gradients are in the radial direction. M is the total mass contained within a radius r. P is the pressure at radius r. Rho is the equivalent mass density at radius r. So if epsilon is the energy density, net relativistic energy density, it is epsilon by c square will be rho. And R, of course, is the radial coordinate. G is the gravitational constant. So it's C is the speed of light. So that's it. So these quantities appear. 2gm by RC squared, you would 2gm by C squared, you would recognize that as a Schwarzschild radius. This equation is called Tolman-Oppenheimer-Walker equation or TOV equation. So this is at the heart of trying to find the structure of neutron stars and used very extensively. Although I think not a single neutron star we know should actually satisfy TOV equation because there is no non-rotating, fully spherically symmetric neutron star. So, but as long as those departures are small, we can stay with this. M of R here, as I said, is mass contained within radius R. This equation, if you ignore general relativity, has a much simpler form, which is this dPdr is gm rho over R squared. And for non-relativistic stellar structure, usually this is the aerostatic equilibrium equation we are normally using. This cannot be solved unless you have some connection between P and rho that is provided, because otherwise there are more unknowns than the number of equations. So that equation, which provides the connection between P and rho, is called the equation of state. Now, if P happens to depend only on rho, then we call it a barotropic equation of state. And a barotropic equation of state will then just give you one algebraic relation, which you can use in this. However, often an equation of state may involve other quantities. For example, in normal stars, it involves not only the expression of pressure involves not only density, but it also involves temperature. So then you specify equation of state in terms of density and temperature, but then again you are short of equations. You'll have to supplement this with additional equations to provide the distribution of temperature. And that then has to come from radiative equilibrium. So if the material is hot, then there is heat transport, and that heat transport is decided by the temperature gradient. Once you say that it is in equilibrium, that means loss of radiation from the surface has to be balanced by something which is generated. So once you put delta T equal to zero, then you can get a coupled equation which also describes the distribution of temperature. So then you can solve that system of equations. And it may not just stop there. The equation of state may depend also on composition. And when you have composition, then you have to again have a way to describe how the composition is distributed across the stellar configuration that you know. So basically, the composition as a function of density and so on has to be specified. This is, although temperature is not such an important thing in neutron stars, composition is a very important component in neutron star equation of state. You have to know, given a density, what should the composition be? And that's when you have to bring in other aspects of physics. For example, in case of neutron star, you will use something like beta equilibrium. So you find the state of matter at any given density. You have to use nuclear physics. So before I get to neutron stars, let me just introduce white dwarfs, and then we'll transit to neutron star from there. We'll see why talk about that. Now, white dwarfs are compact stars with, I would say, the least complications. The dominant part of the pressure that holds up the white dwarf against gravity comes from degeneracy pressure. And these are degeneracy pressure of electrons. And degeneracy pressure, since it has just to do with the Fermi energy of the particles, and since the Fermi energy is in a continuum system, is simply dependent on the density, number density. So the equation of state, pressure density relation, can be written in a very definite manner. Just from the simple consideration of Pauli exclusion principle and number density. This is true for all species, not just for electrons. If you are going to talk about neutron degeneracy pressure, it will also be given by an expression like this. Now, you have to just substitute the neutron number density, neutron. X here is Fermi momentum divided by MEC. and which is expressed in this fashion. So you can see that the Fermi momentum is proportional to the number density to the power of 1/3. Number density in case of white dwarfs comes from the mass density divided by the mean molecular weight times the number of mass of protons, right? So in this respect, white dwarfs will differ considerably from neutron stars. Here, electrons provide the pressure, but electrons don't provide the mass. Electrons provide the pressure, the associated nucleons provide the mass. Mu e just measures how many nucleons are associated with one electron. So for example, if you have your nuclei happen to be helium nuclei, then you have four nucleons associated with two electrons. So mu e is 2. And for any heavier element, mu e is also very close to 2. For hydrogen, it is 1. But the mass that goes into this comes from the, when you talk about mass density, it is not the mass density of electrons. It's the mass density of associated nucleons, because electrons contribute a very small fraction of it, so small that you can ignore it. Imagine if the situation had only neutrons and no protons and electrons, and you still had degeneracy pressure, then in that case, this will be replaced by the neutron mass. And that number density of neutrons will also appear here. But here it doesn't. Here, number density of electrons which appears there, but the mass comes from. Now, why is that important? As you can see, if you keep increasing any, a time will come when the PF will exceed MEC, which means the electrons will become relativistic. Now, once you become relativistic, you cannot use rest mass anymore in the description of inertia. So, in a mass density that is contributed by this, you will have to apply the Lorentz correction, which you can happily ignore in the case of white dwarfs. Even if electrons go relativistic, you still continue to use this expression. So the relation between rho and n does not change depending on n. Otherwise, the connection between n and rho will itself become a function of n, because you'll then have to involve gamma, and gamma will depend on x, and x depends on n. So if you don't use the electron degeneracy, but let us say you go to neutron degeneracy, then this you cannot write so simply anymore. It will be, n will be rho divided by gamma times neutron mass, where gamma is the Lorentz factor, and the Lorentz factor has to be computed from here, and that will depend on number density in itself. Is that clear?
No, slight confusion.
Yes.
Okay. First is that you said that suppose if you take for the white dwarfs,
yeah,
you take helium, it has 2 electrons, so it's 2.
Two electrons and four.
Four.
So mu is the number of atomic mass units associated with the new electron. Yeah. So
that is
2 per electron.
2 per electron.
2 electrons and.
Yes, so 2 by 4.
Yes.
So 2 per electron.
Itself. 2 per electron. So mu is 2.
And then suppose if you take heavier elements.
Yes.
Say
if you take A by Z is almost always equal to 2.
1.5.
Where is 1.5? Which element?
all the stable nuclei, they have this 1.5.
No, it's more like 2. You take any element you produce.
Oh, sorry, that is n by z ratio is almost 1.5, right? In nuclear physics, it's stable, but not A.
A by z, I'm talking about.
Okay. That is okay, that because n and p are almost equal.
Yes.
Number, so it comes as 2.
Comes as 2.
Yes.
Right?
So now when we go for neutrons, we replace mu by mn.
You have to replace mu by gamma mn, where gamma is the Lorentz factor. Right?
Okay, why are we right now bringing, because you said that is a relativistic variability, as we increase the ne.
Yeah, as we increase ne, electrons will go relativistic, neutrons and protons will not.
Right.
So therefore, they still remain non-relativistic, so the gamma is remains 1 here.
Oh, yes.
So it is not connected to any. But if you have neutrons, then if you increase neutron density so much that neutron becomes relativistic, then you have to put a gamma there.
Right.
So this relation itself becomes, the right-hand side itself depends on n in that case. So, which is not the case in case of white dwarf, so that is a very clean system. So if something goes as n to the power of 1/3, you can also say that x goes as rho to the power of 1/3. Because the quantity dividing rho is a constant. It doesn't depend on any. That will not be true in case of neutrons. Okay. Now, so if you put this in and then try to solve your hydrostatic equilibrium equation, in this case, non-relativistic is good enough. Relativity makes a very small difference. I mean, the general relativity makes a very small difference. Special relativity is included in this in any case. So you get a mass radius relation like this. And you can see that there is a upper limit to the white dwarf mass. This horizontal axis is mass in unit of the maximum mass. The maximum mass for mu equal to 2 turns out to be 1.4 times the mass of the sun, and it goes as mu squared. So if mu had been 1, then you will get 5.6 or 5.7 times the mass of the sun. Okay. Now what happens if the configuration has a mass larger than that? Then clearly the electron degeneracy pressure is no longer sufficient to support such a configuration. Now why is there a maximum mass? And that's because exercising the same effect that we were discussing, that momentum becomes so large that the electrons become relativistic. So why is that a problem? That is a problem because the pressure density relation changes. Although the Fermi momentum continues to rise the same way, if you change any, the pressure doesn't. The pressure is a product of the momentum times the velocity. Right? Because you need a flux of momentum. So momentum, velocity, and number density. Basically, this product gives you pressure. So momentum continues to rise the same way. Number density, of course, continues to rise the same way.
Velocity.
But velocity does not rise the same way. As the electrons become relativistic, the velocity saturates at C. Whereas when it is non-relativistic, velocity rises as Pf over m. P over m. Right?
P over m.
P is mv. So v goes as P over m. Then velocity rises as n to the 1/3. So there is this difference of n to the power of 1/3 in the relation between pressure and density between the non-relativistic regime and the relativistic regime. In non-relativistic regime, you get a factor of n to the power of 1/3 from velocity. In relativistic regime, that just becomes constant. So you don't get this extra factor of 1/3. So the pressure density relation goes from P gives you 1/3, velocity gives you 1/3, 2/3, and number density, which gives you 1, which gives you n to the power of 5/3. The pressure goes as n to the power of 5/3 in the non-relativistic regime. And one of the 1/3 factors get dropped when you go to relativistic regime, so it goes as n to the power of 4/3. For white dwarfs, we can just replace n by rho, and we say it goes as rho to the power of 5/3 in non-relativistic regime and rho to the power of 4/3 in the relativistic regime. If you recall the stability conditions under self-gravity in hydrostatic equilibrium, you need the adiabatic index to be larger than 4/3 for an object to be stable. With 4/3 or below, then the object is unstable. So it will not be able to sustain itself and collapse. And that's the reason why, as you go to fully relativistic situation, it will collapse. Now, in this diagram, which is actually from Chandrasekhar's paper, what he draws here is the region of the star. The shaded region is the region of the star where relativistic equation of state has set in. So PF has gone to larger than MC. So start with highly non-relativistic configuration. Even here, the non-relativistic relativistic core is very, very small, very tiny at the center. And then, very quickly, it starts to grow. And as you come here, you can see that almost the entire star has become relativistic. And that's the reason why you get a collapse. What are the radii that we are talking about here? The typical radius of one solar mass white dwarf is about 10,000 kilometers. So we're talking about densities between 1 million to 100 million grams per cubic centimeter. But once the support runs out, then you cannot have a stable configuration at that radius or at that density. And since it is collapsing under self-gravity, its density can only increase with time. The question is there a support available at a different density which will be able to support configurations of this mass at least? If the mass happens to be lower than that, of course it will already stop at white dwarf. But all configurations of mass 1.4 solar mass or larger will have to find a final equilibrium somewhere else. And is it possible to do so? Now, as the collapse proceeds, you still have this mixture of neutrons, protons, electrons in that configuration. And since the volume is now decreasing, number density of all the species are increasing, including the number density of electrons. Now, as the electron number density increases, its Fermi momentum will continue to increase. As the Fermi momentum continues to increase, the Fermi energy, which is square root of me squared c4 plus pf squared c squared, that will also continue to increase. And at some point, the electron Fermi energy will rise above the mass difference between neutrons and protons. If you keep squeezing, the neutrons and protons have a mass difference of about 1 MeV. One is 938, one is 939. So if you take a free neutron and place it on your table, then what will happen is this. Since it's a neutron, then it will roll down the hill to produce a proton and an electron. With as it rolls down, you will get the free neutron will convert itself to a proton, and electron will be released with the whatever kinetic energy that is attributed to it as it goes down. And it will generate antineutron in the process. So between the antineutron electron and proton, it will share the energy that has been gained. By converting a neutron to a proton, you gain 1 million electrons. Now when you start with much higher density, where the electron Fermi energy is such that the sum of the energy of a proton and the electron energy is larger than the rest energy of the neutron, then it will roll the other way.
Above one is in general, right?
At low density.
At low density. Neutrons, that is a free decay of neutrons.
Free decay of neutrons.
Yes.
But at high density, when the electron Fermi energy has been raised to such an extent, see here the electron Fermi energy is low. So this is the level of electron Fermi energy. This is the rest energy of protons. Here the rest energy of neutrons, rest energy of protons. But now electron Fermi energy has been raised such that the sum now goes up there. Now this system on the right hand side is sitting at a higher pedestal than the neutron itself. So the tendency will be to roll that way. Electron and proton will combine to produce a neutron and a neutron. Okay. So what is the effect of this? You started with roughly equal mixture of neutrons, protons and electrons. Right? Now as you squeeze it, electron Fermi energy will begin to rise. And as it rises above this threshold, electrons and protons will start to combine, and neutrons will start getting produced. As neutrons start getting produced, the number density of electrons will begin to fall. If you arrest the collapse, then the number density of electrons will fall to a level where the rate of these two processes will equalize, and you will get an equilibrium density of neutrons, protons and electrons, where the neutron number density now is much higher than it was in the low density region. So matter becomes neutron rich. And the more you squeeze it, the more neutron rich it will become. But there is a limit, which we'll come to in a moment. So this situation is called beta equilibrium.
So dynamically, when it's collapsing, at the time before the equilibrium has set on, so there is a contribution both from the collapse that as well as the conversion, right?
Collapse is causing the conversion.
Yes. So collapse is causing the conversion. So due to conversion, number of neutrons is increasing, and again, as it has collapsed in the next step, due to that, the number density has increased, and this process continues till the equilibrium sets in.
Yeah. So equilibrium will set in weak interaction time scale, which is still much shorter than the dynamical time scale in these cases. So So you will have more or less near equilibrium composition even through the collapse, but of course not the final equilibrium. That will take some time to establish after the collapse has been arrested. And it will take a little bit more time if you now stop this and let it settle down. In the process, a lot of heat will also be produced. So in addition to these energies, you'll also get thermal energy added to it. But thermal energy will leak out over time. So after some time, the thermal energy will become negligible compared to the Fermi energies. So then you can ignore the temperature. Now there will be some slow reactions which will keep continuing until the equilibrium nuclear structure is established under these conditions. And these transmutations happen by what's called these picnonuclear reactions. These are nuclear reactions that are happening not because it is in a high temperature situation, but it is in a high density situation. And the nuclear composition is away from the final equilibrium composition, which beta equilibrium will demand. So because of that imbalance, reactions will continue, and eventually you will get nuclear composition, which is now as expected from all equilibrium conditions. This is called cold catalyzed nuclear matter. And particularly the crustal equation of state of neutron stars is all derived from this condition, that you get to a cold catalyzed nuclear matter state. There have been suggestions in the literature that perhaps this cold catalyzed state is never obtained. You still have trapped energy in the crust. For a long time, local heating goes on by local transmutations in some regions, and then they can continue to release energy, and this can go on for durations longer than the lifetime of typical neutron stars we see. So this is possible, but in general, most of the literature assumes that the crust is composed of cold catalyzed nuclear matter. The latter, where non-equilibrium situation obtains, is probably more relevant to accreted crust, where over a short time a lot of matter has been accumulated on the top of the crust, and then it has had to quickly come to a composition which is dictated by the temperature and pressure of the time when the accretion was occurring. And this may not yet be in a situation where full conversion to cold catalyzed matter has occurred. So there are strong suggestions that in certain accreting situations, you do get crusts which are not in full cold catalyzed matter state, but it has a release of energy over a long time, which can be seen. It's called deep crustal heating. That comes from the fact that there is non-equilibrium matter deep in the crust, which slowly converts over time, and then it keeps heating the crust. But if you do assume that you have cold catalyzed nuclear matter, nuclear physics will tell you at each density what is the type of nucleus you will have. And this people have calculated for a long time. This is a plot of the A by Z as a function of density, grams per cubic centimeter. Goes from 10 to the 6 grams per centimeter cube, which is near the surface of a neutron star to about 10 to the 12 grams per cubic centimeter here, which is close to the bottom of the crust. It's not exactly the base of the crust. The base of the crust comes at nuclear density, which is 2.8 times 10 to the 14 grams per cubic centimeter. But this is the kind of run of A by Z that you get. So as you go to higher and higher density, you can see that the A by Z is going. So the number of neutrons in a nucleus will keep going up in number. But there is up to a limit, this can go on up to a limit. Beyond the point, it is not easy for strong interaction to hold so many neutrons in one nucleus with a small number of protons. So what then happens is you begin to get some neutrons which are not in nuclei, not bound in nuclei. So you now have a mixture of some neutrons which are bound in nuclei, and in between nuclei there is space where free neutrons are moving around. This is not so near the surface. Near the surface you have millions of grams per cc, mostly iron type nuclei, and everything is in nuclei. There is no free neutrons or free protons or free electrons. No nucleons are kept free within nuclei, in between nuclei. Electrons are of course in an itinerant free electron kind of state, like in metals. So they are very energetic and they can go and go large distances in this situation. But as you go to higher densities, you then get neutrons in between nuclei, and this is called neutron drip. So beyond a certain density, you get neutron drip. So you get free neutrons in addition to matter in nucleus.
But these free electrons throughout the star, which is moving around, they can pass through and they can just keep on scattering off from one nucleon to other, right?
That is correct. In the upper part of the crust, at least, nuclei will be in a lattice-like structure. So it will be a crystal-like structure, so just like in metals. And you have
conduction
band and so on. So electrons are mostly in the conduction band. So they can move through the entire region. So this beta equilibrium condition is stated this way, which is mu n is mu p plus mu e, where mu here is defined as the full relativistic pf squared plus m squared c4. Often when you define mu n and mu p, people define it through non-relativistic expression, so only pf is used. In that case, if mu n and mu p are defined as through pf alone, then you'll have to add a term which is mn minus mp c squared. It depends on how it is defined. If you define the full thing in relativistic fashion, then this expression is okay. Now you take this expression, add to it the condition that the mixture is charge neutral, which means the number density of electrons and number density of protons will have to be the same. And then one species which I have not added here, which will also appear, and those are muons. So in addition to this, you will also have muons appearing, and you can include that in the computation as well. So once you have that, just from these conditions alone, you can solve for what is the equilibrium ratio between protons and the total number of neutrons. So what is the proton fraction?
But muons will appear only at much higher densities, right?
It will appear, but it will appear before you get to
get
nuclear density.
At the boundary of the crust.
Definitely before you get to nuclear density, it will begin to appear. So now you take all this and then see what is the equilibrium proton fraction. Then you will find that the proton fraction, as the number density increases, the proton fraction will go down. And then it will go up again. As number density goes to infinity, the proton fraction stabilizes at 1 by 8. Okay. So, at very high density, the proton fraction in neutron, proton, electron, muon mixture will stabilize at 12%, it's 1/8.
I have a question.
No.
So when you say that when we, if anybody use a non-relativistic version, then we replace this mu n by pf, and then we have to bring in this mn minus
mp. Yeah.
I didn't get how.
No. So this expression, if the thing is non-relativistic, you can write as
taking this pf square.
Yeah, pf square
out and then 1 by half of mn square c to the power 4 by pf square.
Yes.
Then.
So and then you.
But it comes as a hand.
Yes. So now the pf alone is the is taken as mu. But the total energy, then you add as CPF plus MC squared.
Total energy CPF plus M.
MC squared.
M of that species.
Correct.
C squared.
Correct. So instead of this, you replace it by CPF plus MC squared.
No, but for beta equilibrium.
Yeah. Actually, I have forgotten C squared here.
Yeah. So for beta equilibrium, we have this mu n, mu p, and mu e only.
Yes.
Now, for establishing the beta equilibrium.
No, this is the correct equation if you write it in the full relativistic form.
Right.
If you don't write it in the full relativistic form, then it is not the correct expression. Then you have to write mu n plus mn c squared is equal to mu p plus mp c squared. Plus,
okay. It's basically non-relativistic case. We have to do the energy balancing of both.
Right. So then you will get a.
Then
have
MN
this,
minus
but
MP.
MN minus MPC squared
and
will come out.
ME is neglected over here.
ME is neglected. And ME anyway, you cannot anymore write it like this because electrons are highly relativistic. Yes. So. Okay. So now. A quick demonstration of why we should be worried about taking GR in case of neutron stars, and why can't we work just like white dwarfs and then see, can I get a good approximation to the neutron star result if you just take the non-relativistic version of it. Aristotle equilibrium equation. This is what happens if you take the same equation of state. I've taken a specific equation of state here. Solve it using the non-relativistic version of the aristotic equilibrium equation. Solve it using the TOB equation. You get completely different results. Now this can also be appreciated from the fact that suppose I say that neutron stars are supported only by neutron degeneracy pressure. Then the same expression which I used to write the maximum mass of the white dwarf can be used to write the maximum mass of the neutron star just by changing the mass of the species?
P and E.
P and E?
Pressure and energy for...
No, pressure and density is given by the exactly the same relation.
Same formula, just M and...
Just M changes.
Yes.
Nothing else changes. M and mu. Mu now becomes 1.
Yes.
And mass of the... Wherever the mass of the electron appears, you have to use mass of the neutron. And you will find that since this thing is the maximum mass is determined by the relativistic part of the equation of state, mass of the neutron or mass of the electron will not explicitly appear in the Fermi momentum. It will only appear in converting the mass density to number density. So it just becomes related to mu e, and it goes as mu e squared. The maximum mass just is given by mu e squared times 1.47. Mu squared times 1.47 mass. So mu to the minus 2, I'm sorry. Mu to the minus 2 times 1.47. Let me be clear about it. So, limiting mass is proportional to mu to the minus 2, okay, times a constant. So this constant is roughly 5.76. You put mu equal to 2, you get 1.44. If you put mu equal to 1, which is the case for neutrons, then you get 5.76. So a neutron star with a non-relativistic hydrostatic equilibrium will suggest that you have a maximum mass limit of neutron stars of 5.7 solids. But I have already shown you that non-relativistic, without general relativity, you do not get the correct structure. So if you use GR and the same equation of state, which gave you 5.76 solar mass with non-relativistic hydrostatic equilibrium, gives you this. This is pure Fermi gas equation of state. Your degeneracy pressure, the TOB equation, you get maximum mass limit of 0.71 in the solar mass, which is the Oppenheimer-Volkoff limit, because this was already calculated by Oppenheimer-Volkoff in 1939. So this number is drastically reduced to 0.7 just because of GR. And because the object is so compact. So the GR is absolutely paramount in treating anything to do with neutron star structure, anything to do with self-gravity near neutron stars. But it also exposes another problem. You have the general myth that neutron stars are supported by neutron degeneracy pressure. If that were true, then we would actually have no neutron stars at all. Because the route to forming a neutron star is by going above the white dwarf mass limit. And if you have already crossed the white dwarf mass limit, you're carrying a mass more than 1.4 solar mass, that will never be supported by neutron degeneracy pressure, because the maximum mass limit in neutron degeneracy pressure is only 0.7 solar mass, only half of the white dwarf mass limit. So what are neutron stars supported by then? The essential component in the support of neutron star comes from nuclear forces. Without nuclear forces, there will be no support for a neutron star. So degeneracy pressure does contribute to the total support, but it's a small fraction. The main component comes from nuclear forces. And so if you take a look at the interaction potential between two nucleons, then what you have is, at somewhat large distances, strong interaction gives you an attractive potential. But when the nucleons are very close, then you get a below one Fermi, then you begin to get a repulsive potential. And it is this repulsive potential then that gives you outward pressure to support the neutron star against gravity. And clearly, the outward support that you get will depend very closely on what is the slope of this curve. Because you're talking about equation of state, so that is pressure-density relation. So as you bring the nucleons closer together, how fast does the repulsion increase? That decides the equation of state, and that decides the support against gravity. Now, this regime for cold matter experimentally cannot be probed in terrestrial laboratories. There's no way. And theoretically, this is a difficult arena to grasp. I will mention a couple of reasons why it is so. So as it happens, today we have a large diversity in the predictions of what the VR versus R is in this region. And since you do not know that very well, we actually do not know the neutron star equation of state very well. And since we do not know the neutron star equation of state very well, we do not know their mass radius relation very well. There is a very strong attempt from astrophysical observations to constrain this. I will touch upon some of those as we go along. But this is one of the key drivers of neutron star astrophysics today. Trying to find out how does matter fundamentally behave at very high density. So what is the nature of nuclear forces when you bring nucleons very, very close to each other? So I think this will be a good point to stop here today. We'll take it up in the next class.
I have one question.
Yeah.
So the argument that you have shown that if it is a complete, if we have this space just degenerate pressure supported, replaced by the neutron, then with the mu to be 1, we should have 5.76. But when we incorporate GR, it goes down to 0.7. Right. And then from there, you said that if it was completely degenerative pressure supported, then we wouldn't have seen any neutrons.
Yes, because how neutrons cannot be produced, you will not produce a configuration of 0.7 solar mass.
Before it has reached the...
Yeah, so unless it has already crossed the white dwarf mass limit, there will be no collapse.
Yeah, so then in that case, it should have been something like that. It has gone to 1.4 and then
it has come back to 0.7.
0.7, which is unfeasible.
Yeah.
Okay.